Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. To carry on with the special embryology lectures, I'm going to talk today about the development of the ear. I'm Dr. Dalia Saleh, professor and the head of anatomy department at Mansoura University, Egypt. Let's talk first about the anatomy of the ear. The ear, as you can see in this diagram, is divided into three regions: the external ear, the middle ear, and the internal ear. Let's focus now on the external ear. It is formed of the following: the auricle or the pinna. It is made of cartilage, that's why you can move it easily. It's flexible and you can move it easily. The external auditory meatus, which is made of a canal, partly made of cartilage and partly made of bones. This canal ends at the eardrum or the tympanic membrane. The tympanic membrane separates the external ear from the middle ear. If we have a look at the ear pinna, it is a complicated structure made of the following areas. We have the helix, and here we can see what is called the tubercle. We have the antihelix, the tragus, the antitragus, the concha, the triangular fossa, and this small area below is called the ear lobule. It's very soft because it's made of fat. To summarize the development of the external ear, we have the following. The ear pinna arises from fusion of six auricular hallux. The external auditory meatus is ectodermal in origin from the first pharyngeal cleft. The tympanic membrane or the eardrum is made of three layers: inner, middle, and outer layers. The inner layer is endodermal in origin. The outer layer is ectodermal in origin, while the middle layer is mesodermal in origin. For the development of the auricle or ear pinna, there are six hallux. They are mesenchymal proliferation, arise from both the first and second pharyngeal arches. They appear by the end of the fourth week of development. They surround the first pharyngeal cleft on both sides. So as we can see here, these are the six auricular helixes bounding the first pharyngeal cleft. Later on, they will grow and fuse together to form the definitive auricle. So number one will be the tragus, number six the antitragus, two and three are the helix, four and five the antihelix. Initially, the ears are seated below in the lower neck region, but with further development of the head and neck region and development of the mandible, they both ascend to the sides of the head at the level of the eyes. As you can see, the development of the auricle is very complicated, so it is common to have abnormalities of the auricular region. The anomalies of the auricle are often associated with anomalies of the first and second pharyngeal arches, as we can see in this diagram. For the development of the external auditory meatus, it develops from the dorsal aspect of the first pharyngeal cleft. And to remind you, the first pharyngeal cleft is this space or this groove between the first and second pharyngeal arches. So at the third month of development, epithelial cells at the bottom of the meatus proliferate and multiply to form a solid epithelial plate. We call it the meatal block. This block grows more deep and deep towards a ring. We call it the tympanic ring. At the seventh month of pregnancy, this block begins to dissolve, and the epithelial lining of the floor of the meatus participates in the formation of the outer layer of the definitive eardrum. Remember, it is made of ectoderm. Congenital deafness develops if the metal block did not dissolve and persist till the time of birth. For the anatomy of the middle ear, it is made of two components, the middle ear cavity and the nasopharyngeal tube that connects the middle ear cavity to the nasopharynx. The middle ear cavity is more or less looks like a box, has six walls, lateral wall, medial wall, roof, floor, anterior wall, which is removed in this diagram, and the one at the back that you can see now is the posterior wall. We can see inside the middle ear cavity three bony ossicles, the malleus, the incus, and the stapes. If we enlarge this picture to have a good look, we can see the tympanic membrane separates the middle ear cavity from the external auditory meatus. On the medial wall, we can see the promontory made by the cochlea, the oval window, which is closed by the foot of the stapes. At the back, we can see the mastoid antrum. And in the middle ear cavity, you can see the three bony ossicles, the malleus attached to the eardrum, the incus, and the stapes. You also can see two muscles, the tensor tympani attached to the malleus and the stapedius muscle attached to the stapes. So, to summarize the development of the middle ear cavity and the eustachian tube or the nasopharyngeal tube, their epithelial lining are derived from the endoderm of the first pharyngeal pouch, while the middle ear ossicles are derived from the pharyngeal arches mesoderm, the malleus and the incus from the first pharyngeal arch, while the stapes from the second pharyngeal arch. The middle ear cavity and the auditory tube arise from the first pharyngeal pouch, as I said before, from an area called the tubotympanic sulcus, which is lined by endoderm. This pouch expands in a lateral direction and comes in contact with the floor of the first pharyngeal cleft. The distal part of this pouch forms what's called the tubotympanic recess, while its proximal part will form the eustachian tube. Later, the endodermal epithelium of the tubotympanic sulcus get close to the ectodermal lining of the first pharyngeal cleft and they will be separated by mesoderm. This complex will form the tympanic membrane or the eardrum. This is another diagram showing the development of the eardrum. During the fetal life, a prominent ring called the tympanic ring supports the tympanic membrane during its development. Later on, this tympanic ring becomes absorbed into the temporal pore. Just dorsal to the tubotympanic sulcus, three condensation of mesenchyme appears at the 6th week of development, and this mesodermal condensation will form the middle ear ossicles, the malleus, the incus, and the stapes. The malleus and the incus arise from the mesenchyme of the first pharyngeal arch, while the stapes arise from the mesenchyme of the second pharyngeal arch. The tensor tympani muscle, which is attached to the malleus, is also derived from the mesoderm of the first pharyngeal arch, and it is innervated by the trigeminal nerve, specifically from the mandibular nerve branched to the medial pterygoid muscle. While the stapedius muscle arises from the second pharyngeal arch mesoderm and it is innervated by the facial nerve. Remember that the mandibular nerve is the nerve of the first arch while the facial nerve is the nerve of the second arch. Early in development, the ossicles lie in a bed of very loose embryonic connective tissue that fills the middle ear cavity and extends laterally from the inner layer of the tympanic membrane to the oval window close to the inner ear medially. The middle ear cavity remains filled with this loose mesenchyme until late in pregnancy. During the 8th and 9th months of pregnancy, programmed cell death takes place and the embryonic tissue filling the middle ear cavity begins to dissolve and disappear. So, the middle ear cavity is now clear and the auditory ossicles are suspended within it. Free movement of the auditory ossicles is acquired within 2 months after birth. In this section, we can notice the middle ear cavity, the Eustachian tube, and the mastoid ear cells and the mastoid antrum. So during late fetal life, the tympanic cavity expands dorsally to form the tympanic antrum. After birth, the epithelium of the tympanic cavity invades the bone of the developing mastoid process. Later, most of the mastoid ear sacs come in contact with the antrum and the tympanic cavity. Now let's move to the anatomy of the inner ear. The inner ear lies within the petrous part of the temporal bone of the skull. It is made of two parts. Outer bony part, we call it the bony labyrinth, and inner membranous part, we call it the membranous labyrinth. Let's have a look at it. You can notice both the outer bony labyrinth made of three areas. The cochlea, which looks like a snail shell, the vestibule, and the three semicircular canals. Within the cochlea, we have the cochlear duct, and from there, the cochlear division of the 8th cranial nerve arises. Inside the vestibule, we have the saccule and utricle, and inside the three semicircular canals, we have the three semicircular ducts. From the saccule, utricle, and the three semicircular ducts, the vestibular division of the vestibulocochlear nerve arises. If we take a section in the cochlea, you notice that it is made of an axis of bone called the modulus, upon which the cochlea rotates around. In each turn, we can see that the cochlea is divided into three compartments: scala vestibuli, scala tympani, and in the middle we have the scala media. The scala vestibuli is separated from the scala media by the vestibular membrane. The scala tympani is separated from the scala media by the Peisman membrane. Both scala vestibuli and scala tympani contains perilymph. The scala media contains the cochlear duct, the organ of Corti, and it is filled with endolymph. Let's have a look to the posterior wall or posterior aspect of the membranous labyrinth and to see how the compartments of the membranous labyrinth communicate with each other. We can see here the cochlear duct. In the middle we have the saccule connected to the cochlear duct by a small duct called ductus reunion. We have a larger structure here, it is the utricle. The utricle is connected to the saccule by a Y-shaped duct. They unite to form the endolymphatic duct, which terminates at the endolymphatic sac. And then we have the three semicircular canals, each of which has an ambulated end and non-ambulated end. They open by five openings into the utricle. To summarize the development of the inner ear, the membranous labyrinth is derived from the ectodermal invagination from the otic placode, while the bony labyrinth is derived from the surrounding mesoderm. In this diagram, we can see how the otic vesicle develops. Early in the fourth week of development, a thickening of the surface ectoderm on each side of the hind brain gives rise to the otic placode. The otic placode then forms a pit called the otic pit. pinch it down to form the otic vesicle. Then it loses its connection with the rest of the ectoderm and later on develops into the membranous labyrinth. So each vesicle divides into a ventral portion and a dorsal portion. The ventral compartment will give rise to the saccule and the cochlear duct, while the dorsal compartment or dorsal portion of the otic vesicle will give rise to the rest of the membranous labyrinth, the utricle, the semicircular canals, and also the endolymphatic duct and interlymphatic sac. Let's start with the development of the saccule and the cochlea and the organ of Corti. So in the sixth week of development, the saccular lower part penetrates the surrounding mesenchyme in a spiral fashion to form the cochlear duct. It completes about 2.5 turns at the end of the eighth week of development. The saccule remains connected to the cochlear duct by the ductus reunions, and the mesenchyme surrounding the cochlear duct will form the pony labyrinth. In the 10th week of development, the cartilaginous shell around the cochlear duct undergoes vacuolization, and the two perilymphatic spaces, the scala vestibuli and the scala tympani, are formed. The vestibular membrane separates the cochlear duct from the scala vestibuli, while the basilar membrane separates the cochlear duct from the scala tympani. The spiral ligament attaches the lateral wall of the cochlear duct to the surrounding cartilage. The median angle of the cochlear duct is connected to and partially supported by the long cartilaginous process, the modulus. The modulus, as I said in the anatomy slide before, it is the future axis of the pony cochlea around which the cochlea will rotate around. So the cochlear duct is partially supported by part of the modulus, we call it the spiral lamina, and the rest will be the basement membrane. The epithelial cells of the cochlear duct is formed of two ridges. An inner ridge, it's called the spiral limbus, and an outer ridge is made by the sensory hair cells. The sensory hair cells are also arranged in two rows, inner row and outer row. These cells are covered by a membrane called the tectorial membrane. The sensory cells plus the tectorial membrane together will form the organ of Corti or organ of hearing. Impulses received from this organ will be transmitted by the spiral ganglia to the 8th cranial nerve. For the development of the utricle and the 3 semicircular canals, during the 6th week of development, the semicircular canals appear as flattened outpockings of the utricular part of the otic vesicle. The central portions of the walls of these outpockings opposed to each other disappear, and thus we have the semicircular canal. Each canal has two ends, a dilated end, we call it the crus ampullari, and a non-dilated end, we call it the crus non-ampullari. We have 3 semicircular canals, as you can see here, the anterior, the posterior, and the lateral semicircular canals. Each has two ends, dilated end or ampullated end and non-ampullated end. The two non-dilated ends of the anterior and the posterior semicircular canals unite together and open by the same cross into the utricle. Thus, we have 5 crura enter the utricle, 3 with an ampulla and 2 without. Cells in the ampullae from the semicircular canals form a crest. We call it crista ampullaris. They contain sensory cells for detection of angulated movement. Similar sensory cells are found in the walls of the utricle and saccule. They are responsible for detection of linear movement. So, the utricle, saccule, and the semicircular canals are responsible for detection of movement, and they are supplied by the vestibular division of the vestibulocochlear nerve or 8th cranial nerve. The dorsal aspect of the otic vesicle, as I mentioned before, develops into the utricle, the three semicircular canals, and what is called endolymphatic duct and sac. So, the auditory vesicle elongates and develops on its medial side into a duct. We call it the endolymphatic duct and terminates at the endolymphatic sac. It continues to grow postnatally until the age of 3 or 4 years old. And as we can see here, it extends into the petrous part of temporal bone, and the endolymphatic sac can be seen in the cranial fossa under the meninges. This is the end of my presentation. Thanks for listening. If you like it, please do not forget to subscribe, like, and share. And do not forget to hit the notification bell so you can be notified if I upload another video.